All right, good morning. Welcome to Nichols Bus Compound. Happy to be here with you today as we are now 15 days away from the first day of school. So first and foremost, I want to thank all of our hard workers here in transportation, all across the district who are working so hard to get ready for the start of school. We are really excited about the start of this school year. As I've said multiple times, the magnitude of change that we have in JCPS is greater than I think we've had in decades, probably since 1976 with the consolidation of the city and the county school system and desegregation. And so massive changes we've had, so we've worked hard throughout the summer to make sure we are prepared for these big changes. So today, this is the first in a series of press conferences we're gonna have talking about the changes that we have coming to JCPS. Today, we wanted to start and focus in on transportation. We know that is a huge issue with families and parents. Proud of the work that we're doing. We are the second largest transportation system in the state, next to UPS. In JCPS, we transport over 60,000 students on an average school day, drive about 78,000 miles each school day. Obviously, safety is our top priority, but we also know last year with the many changes we're gonna have to make based on shortage of bus drivers and change in start times, we could not repeat the same thing that we did last year. So definitely with the amount of double and triple runs, meaning our staff had to stay at school longer to monitor kids. Kids had to stay at school longer, and unfortunately, a lot of instructional time was missed because of a shortage of bus drivers. So we have thousands of students getting to school late, and we just could not repeat that for another year. We had to make these changes, and that's why our board approved our Start Smart plan back in March. As you know, I've said this multiple times, we were one of only a couple of large school systems across the United States who had only two start times, one for middle and high school and one for elementary school. That's just not sustainable, and it just shows that's the way it's been for decades, and we had to make changes. We had to add start times to space out those bus runs. We had to make sure as a result of that we would have fewer bus routes. And so now, at this point right now, we have more bus drivers than we have bus routes. And that's for the first time in several years that we start each school day with more bus drivers on staff than bus routes. And so what that means is we won't have these unanticipated double and triple runs, meaning a bus driver is going to have to go pick up drop kids off at school and then go make another run. And some of our triple runs, that leads to students becoming late to school over multiple hours. And obviously that was a domino effect from middle to high to elementary. And so once, as a result of this, we will not have students getting to school late and missing hours of instruction. We had about 20,000 students miss instructional time this past year because of late buses. But we know this is going to be a huge lift. There is no doubt. I mean, we have the majority of our schools changing their start times. And we know it's not easy. We know it's caused some inconveniences for families. But getting kids to school on time, not missing instruction, is our number one goal as we do this, and that's what we are accomplishing. Obviously, we're asking families to be patient with us, our buses, our transportation system. This is a huge lift. We're confident that we're going to be successful in it, but there's no doubt when you have the major change that we are taking on, not just in transportation, but in many other areas, there's going to be kinks and hiccups that we're going to have to work out. So parents, we definitely need your help in this. First and foremost, know what time your child's school starts. Once again, I believe it's over 80% of our schools are changing a start time. Make sure to communicate with your school about start times. Check on our website if you need to know that. You'll receive some information as well about your start time in the week ahead. Know what your bus stop is. That is critical. A difference in order to maximize efficiency. Many times in the past, we've had what's called mirroring, which means students would have the same bus number in the morning and in the afternoon, which dramatically increased our bus routes. So parents need to know it may be a different bus number in the afternoon than the morning. So it's important to talk to your child about that. We will have lots of help at schools to make sure our kids know that, but the more kids know as they come to school, the better off it will be. Obviously, don't wait till the first day of school or the day before to explore these. As I said, we got 2 weeks from tomorrow to start school. We're going to have a lot of activity at the school level and communications with that, but make sure that you communicate with your school and have all this information ahead of time. If there are problems or concerns with bus stops, we have a link on our webpage that allows parents to log on and ask for a change in a bus stop or clarification. We can provide that as well. So once again, I'd like to thank our transportation department for their hard work, our bus drivers for continuing to support, you know, our most precious commodity in our community, which is our kids getting to school and getting home safely. I can't say enough about how challenging that first day is going to be. It's just each and every time we're transporting nearly 70,000 students to and from school on the first day of school. Many of our students, our youngest students, may not know the buses they're on, and so we have to clearly communicate with families and kids to make sure that we get home safely. And often what we do is make sure that we're very methodical in that approach to get our kids home safely. But we know this is going to be a bigger challenge than it's ever been before just because of the big changes. But we're excited about that first day of school. We're excited about getting every kid to school on time and having more bus drivers than bus routes. To talk a little bit more about this is our Chief Operations Officer, Chris Perkins. Chris, come on up.
Thanks, Dr. Polio. Good morning. I'm excited to be here with you today, and as Dr. Polio said, we have several changes on the horizon, but I want you to know that we've been hard at work for several months in preparation for August 9th, and we're very excited about the first day of school and much more confident in our transportation system this year going into it just based on how we've routed and the number of drivers we have available. You know, last year, we were running about 650 drivers on a daily basis to cover well over 700 routes. And when you broke those routes down into individual legs, we called those runs, we had well over 900 runs. This year, as Dr. Polio mentioned, we have fewer routes than we do drivers, so that's good. That should alleviate our need to make triple runs and really minimize the number of double runs out there to and from our schools. Last year, we just simply could not logistically manage the magnitude of routes that we've had historically. But again, that's changed this year. We have more start times, fewer routes, and enough drivers to cover those. We want families to know and be aware of what bus their child will ride, where the nearest bus stop is, and what time the bus should arrive. So we have Bus Finder here to help. And anyone can go to Bus Finder, parents, students, school personnel. You simply enter a home address and the child's school, and Bus Finder will tell you the nearest bus stop and what time that bus is scheduled to arrive. Additionally, transportation letters are going out this week to families that will identify the same information. If your student does not have a bus stop, please go to the Back to School website from the JCPS homepage, and it's right there to find the link to the bus stop request form. This year, we also have QR codes, as you see to my right, that will be available at our middle and high schools. You simply take a smartphone and scan that QR code, and it will take you directly to Bus Finder. So a student or family member can enter the bus stop or can enter the home address and the school, and it will identify what the bus stop is, the bus, and the time it's picking up. Again, these will be placed in our middle and high schools. Elementary schools will continue using the tagging system that we've had in place now for the last 10, 12 years to help each student know what bus they ride. I encourage everyone whose child is riding a bus to check out Bus Finder in the coming weeks. Do it today if you have the opportunity. Make sure you know your child's bus number, where the nearest bus stop is, and what time your child will be picked up. You may want to check this again before school starts as we're continuing to make adjustments, refining our system, just to make sure that you have accurate information. School buses on the road over the next couple weeks, simulating their bus routes, practicing their stops and turns to simulate what the actual routes will look like, to improve our timing, and to ensure that we've got our routes covered. A few additional notes. Students who live within a one-mile radius of school do not have access to a bus unless there are special circumstances or unless they're crossing a four-lane highway, for example. We've also consolidated some stops to make our routing more efficient. This means some students may have to walk a little bit further to the bus stop. Our average walk-to-stop distance is right around a quarter of a mile this year. Bus Finder went live yesterday, so we're continually getting feedback on that. If you find a discrepancy with your child's bus stop, simply fill out the bus stop request form on our back to school website. We'll get that information and continue making revisions to ensure efficiencies on the first day. Please have some grace with us on that first few days of school. This is all new to our drivers and staff, as well as families. We're asked for your patience. We know there will be some challenges, as Dr. Polio said. Some buses may be crowded to start the school year off with. We'll make adjustments as available. And we also be double-checking students on the first day of school to make sure that we get the right kids on the right bus going to the right destination. This takes a little additional time. So we ask for your patience those first few days, as we know there will be some delays. Starting Monday, August 7th, so 2 days before school starts, we'll have our phone lines up. 485-RIDE, R-I-D-E, is our call center. If you have questions, need any type of support, you can call 485-RIDE. We can get some support to you or help answer your questions. Again, we're proud of our bus drivers. Our transportation staff has been hard at work long before the summer started, even, to ensure that August 9th goes off without a hitch. We're confident in our ability to get your child to and from school each day safely and efficiently. At this time, I'll turn it back to Dr. Polio, and we'll entertain any questions you may have.
You get to see our brand new bus back here behind. So our new bus, as you can see, are a little bit bigger. They have 78 passenger seats. So provides us a little bit more opportunity to spread the kids out when needed. So happy to take any questions. Yeah, Chris, you want to answer that?
Yeah. Yes, thank you. Parents, again, if you find a glitch in your child's bus stop information, just contact us. We'll make sure that we address that. There have been a few isolated incidents where we found a duplication of a bus stop, and so in that case, it's putting two p.m. stops or two a.m. stops, so we'll fix those as they become made aware of it to us.
So every single parent that sees that should fill out a form, or is this something we've seen from viewers that's more widespread?
Okay, yeah. As they become aware of that, they'll make us aware of it. We'll address it. It's they've been isolated incidents that we've identified so far.
You talked about hiccups and kinks. Some parents are taking to social media to vent because their kids have to walk long distances longer than before. They have to arrive at the bus stop longer than before. They're spending more time on the bus longer than before. Is this going to be a common issue, or do you think those are just isolated incidents and they're being vocal on social media?
Well, once again, I'll say this. We're facing some challenging times nationwide when it comes to, you know, buses and transportation all across this nation and counties all across the Commonwealth. We're not canceling any routes. We are transporting. We are not a district who makes decisions like other districts that says we'll only transport students to a reside school and that's all. We transport all students to everywhere they go. What that requires is some give and take. And so there is nothing more important to me than making sure that we get 96,000 kids to school on time, and that we make sure that, yes, every single student is there on time. We are not having to monitor kids, and kids aren't having to be at school from 6:30 in the morning until 6 at night. So yeah, there are some changes and some inconveniences that I think we'll all have to face, but getting kids to school on time and getting them home on time is our number one goal in this.
What's on time to you? We've seen some elementary kids getting home with the bus finder at 6:03 p.m.
Well, I mean, I'd have to see that once again. I mean, we have schools finishing later than before, but it depends on the school that they are choosing to go to. If it's a farther away from home from school, or it's a magnet, yes, that's going to take longer to get there. There is no doubt. We have kids, thousands of kids, who are coming to compounds and have to switch to multiple buses. That's a choice that families make, and if they make that, it is going to be a little bit longer before they get home. But what we don't want are kids getting to school at 6:30 a.m. and sitting at school until 6 p.m. like we did last year. I'm not aware of that. I don't know. We'd have to check that individually and see. I don't think that's the case, but I need to see individually what that is.
So you do think they're going to daycares in general, maybe?
Yeah, I can't comment on that. I'd have to find out.
You mentioned students who live within a mile of the school don't have a bus. Do you know if there are a number of students that maybe live about a mile away, or maybe you're responsible for walking? Is there any kind of accommodations for those students?
I think it's
within a 1 mile radius.
That's the way it's been, hasn't
Correct.
It? Yeah, it's been that way. That's no change. You want to answer that, Chris?
Yeah, actually, there are state regulations as far as walk-to-stop distances. We're well within those. The average walk-to-stop distance for us right now is 0.26 miles. And so that's a slight increase from last year. And that's average.
And that governs the kind of streets they have to cross to?
Yeah, absolutely. That's correct, yep. Yep, they have to have a safe route to the bus stop as well. And if not, then we make accommodations to reroute the bus or assign them to a different bus. That correct. There's the form on JCPS Back to School website. They can request a bus stop.
Similarly, is there a regulation or a goal for how long students should be on the bus? Is there a max that if it's 3 hours, we probably won't do it? Is there any kind of guidelines?
As far as the actual length or time on the bus, no. There's no regulation for that we're aware of.
Did you guys have a goal in mind?
Well, I mean, ideally, you want to minimize the amount of time students spend on buses. We were able to do that just in our routing this year.
It's less, isn't it?
It's less, that's correct. That doesn't mean that some students won't have a longer bus ride, but by and far the average is less time on the bus.
There may be a large number of parents inconvenienced by this, but how much more important is it to take care of the thousands of kids that were showing
sure.
up to school late every day already?
Well, there's no doubt about it. We have to value instructional time. And I want to say that when kids are late to school, that is not or arriving very early or staying very late. That's just that. Yes, that's a huge inconvenience for parents and families and the student. I heard from parents over and over again last year that my child is having to sit at school for an hour and a half after school because of double and triple runs that we've now eliminated. So you're probably not hearing from those families that now are having their kids picked up within 20 minutes after school to be taken home. And so that's a huge thing for the families, but also the staff at school. I mean, we have to look at teachers that had kids missing class and now how they had to make up for kids who might have missed class because their bus was an hour late to school. Or the staff that has to sit at school and monitor students until buses come back. So this is a huge benefit for students, families, and staff that we are doing that, yes, may cause some inconveniences, there is no doubt, but getting kids to school on time, having them picked up on time is can't underscore enough the importance of that. Well, I've been in our the war room or the command center, where, you know, and I want to reiterate this. I mean, you know, what we are talking about are 5-year-olds going to school often who, you know, may not have all the information that they need about where they live, what their address is, things like that. And so the hardest part of this is navigating our 5- and 6-year-olds, especially those that have to come to a compound and switch buses because their family has chosen a magnet school or a different program, which we encourage. But imagine how challenging that is for a 5-year-old and making sure that the staff gets them to the right place. And so, you know, that I can't say enough about how challenging that is. And then each and every day becomes a little bit better and a little bit quicker, and we usually begin to, you know, I hear people say, like, when the first day when kids get home at 6:30, why does it take so long? Well, our elementary schools especially are spending additional time with these kids, making sure they're on the right bus at the right time. They know what bus to switch to at the compound. That's just not easy work, and it takes a lot of time. But as a child gets that, day 2 is quicker, day 3 is quicker, and we usually shave by the time about the first week is done with school. We get into that second week, Tuesday and Wednesday, we're down to about an hour quicker getting everybody home.
You mentioned new buses. Do we know about how many of the new buses will be rolling out this school year?
We ordered 30.
We've ordered 30 of those. I think we're still waiting on some to come, and supply chain challenges make it difficult, but 30 new buses, and that these are the ones we'll continue to order as we move ahead. Well, no. We're not even close to being all filled. I mean, so right now we're in the neighborhood of about 620 bus drivers with 600 routes. That's not an exact number. It's very fluid, but about 620. We then hire a lot of drivers that we've done over the past few years, activity drivers at schools to fill in routes, so those will pick up. And so we've had as high as about a decade ago over 900 bus drivers. I don't see a time where we'll ever be to that again, but we'll continue to hire as many as we can. We would like to have 100 more bus drivers than we have routes. So as you can see from those numbers, I mean, we would still like to hire up to 100 more bus drivers.
How does the fleet of buses compare to last year's quantity?
The actual buses themselves? Well, I mean, it's the same. I mean, we've got new ones, but then we take some out of, you know, each they rotate out. We replace old ones with the new ones. We do not have a shortage of buses. That will not be a problem at any time in the near future, I don't think. So it's the people on the drivers on there that becomes the issue. Well, I think it helps. You know, state regulation on a regular bus like these is 66 passengers that are on a bus, which is crowded. I mean, it is crowded, but 66 is the state law. And so are these 78? Is that right? So when you have 78, that obviously means you can have more kids on the bus. 12 more is allowed by state law. But, you know, even if there's still 66 on that bus, now you have kids that are able to spread a little bit more, and it's not quite as tight.
Very good.
Thanks, guys. Have a great one.